Doc, how's it going?
I'm good, man.
Good?
Always a pleasure to see you.
Indeed, indeed, indeed. It has certainly been a different world for entertainers the last 18 months, couple of years. And so how have you had to deal with it?
Well, like everybody else, one day at a time. And my faith is what's kept me going, man. I mean, people are like, what's next? I'm like, you tell me. You know, we just take it day by day.
And because one of the things that is interesting, I've interviewed numerous entertainers, especially folks who are singers, and you feed off of the energy of the crowd. People ask me the same thing. Given a virtual speech, it's not the same when I'm at that podium and you've got people and you've got energy and the anticipation. It's just a whole different animal.
Energy is tangible. It's when you don't do it, you don't really realize how much, but it's tangible. Like when I'm on stage in certain places, you can actually feel the love.
Oh, yeah.
The energy coming back to you. So it's tough. One of the hardest things is making an album, but making it feel good in the studio. Mm-hmm. When it's just you and a mic and no lights and no wardrobe and no crowd. That's an art form.
And oh, it is. I can't tell you how many, it's very interesting. I was listening to, several Jill Scott records.
Mm-hmm.
I liked them. Mm-hmm. But it wasn't until
you saw
she
her.
Performed at Essence and I heard the live version.
Mm-hmm.
It's just like when Fantasia won American Idol, mm-hmm. the song that put her over the top. I have that one, mm-hmm. and I snatched it off of television. Then I have the studio version.
It's hard.
It's just a whole different feeling, whole different vibe, which I think is part of the reason why there's so many gospel albums alive.
Mm-hmm. 'Cause you capture the spirit, and that's Mr. Martin.
Daddy. I'm Roland.
Okay, just respect, respect. Back in the day, like the Love Alive album, Walter Hawkins,
mm-hmm.
Chains. That song is like 12 minutes long,
mm-hmm.
and they would play the whole song. And you felt like you had church, but now you better do it in 3 minutes or you're not gonna get played.
That's interesting because that was a song that the Salem Baptist Church Choir Chicago did. It's like a 13-minute song.
Oh yeah.
And man, and so when you play it, it's like it builds and builds.
And you're in the experience.
Yes. Otis Clay has a song called Precious Precious, live in Tokyo.
Okay.
And that's a 6.5-minute organ solo by Charles Rogers.
Okay, wow.
Bruh. You take that, and then, or you take that Sam Cooke live at the Harlem Square Club,
mm-hmm.
and you listen to him bringing it home to me and Somebody Have Mercy. Yeah. Totally different. Feeling and sound. And man, you in the car, that's why I can't really say it since we in a church. But I call it these awe songs. What songs for you, whether they're gospel, whether they're R&B, whether they're whatever, that when it comes on, that's gonna make you just.
Oh yeah,
it just hits you.
There's a lot of them. There's a lot, and I was talking to someone the other day. I was hearing the song "Stand" by Donnie McClurkin.
Mm-hmm.
That song just has God's hand on it. It's something about that song, it just does it. And there's so many songs like that. But as to back to your point, it's such a difference with no audience. I mean, I hate it, honestly. I don't like it, but I thank God for it.
Right.
And the medium of television allows us to still have church. I've not missed one Sunday at my church.
Mm-hmm.
But because of on camera, but this coming up is going to be our first Sunday with people in the mm-hmm. audience. Yeah, so.
Okay, so you said Stand.
I love that song.
Give me a few others that, again, when it comes on, I don't care what mood you in, I don't care where you are, you could be on a plane.
Well, believe it or not.
Somewhere, and when it hit, man, you just like, I don't care what y'all think,
yeah.
I'm just about to go.
Believe it or not, because I'm a gospel singer, but Ella Fitzgerald is like, hands down, the greatest singer of all time.
Really?
To me. So whenever I'm anywhere and I hear her voice, I'm like, that's Ella. She's phenomenal. She's perfect. Perfect.
See, I think that is when we talk about music,
mm-hmm.
there we talk about art is art. So you, yeah, obviously definitely. You have movies, you have television, you have artwork. But I don't believe that there is any other art form that can match the emotion, the intensity, the, I mean, no matter what mood you're mm-hmm. in, no matter where you are, whether folk can speak the language mm-hmm. or not, music is just, the most incredible art form, whether they are spoken words or whether it's just music or whether the whole thing is just a hum.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. We have a large amount of success in Japan. And I met a guy, they called him Little Kurt Carr. Now, so you know he's short if they call him Little.
Yeah, that'd be funny if they call him Little Kurt Carr. He was 6'5".
No, he's shorter than me. But this guy knows every single song that I've ever done.
Wow.
And can't speak any English. I said, you know the whole language if you put all them songs together. But it was just phenomenal to me. Amazing. But like you said, music transcends generation. It transcends culture. It transcends everything.
We were talking about Nigeria mm-hmm. and gospel.
Yeah.
When I was in Ghana in 2008, mm-hmm. I've been to a whole lot of Holy Ghost-filled church experiences mm-hmm. in the United States.
Yeah.
But bruh.
They put us to shame.
Bruh.
I'll never forget Mr. Ooh. Martin. We were in Nigeria for this thing called The Experience. It was 200,000 people. And it wasn't a rainstorm, it was a typhoon. A typhoon, literally, like rain I've never seen before. It was me, Donnie McClurkin, and Mary, and Ty Tribbett. It was like 8 different artists. And the power went out. And they stood there in a typhoon. How great is our God? See, it was the most humbling thing I've ever seen in my life.
Man.
So no one could perform. No, none of us could perform. I think Fred sang early because he had to leave and he was able to perform, but nobody, it rained for hours and they stood there.
Didn't leave.
No, and at the very end, they had an emergency generator light that would, all of the artists at least go out on the stage to let them know that you are here.
Right.
And I was standing next to Erica and Tina, Mary, and their hair was like matted to their face because it was that wet. And
right.
They were like, Kurt, have you ever seen anything like this?
So.
Because you know, had that been America, we'd have been at home.
Oh no, it would have been shut down.
They would have been shut
down. So rain comes in and the crowd just sang?
They did not, they just sang. They just started singing hymns to God and just worshiping God. And they're not worshiping him for a new car, or a nice house, or designer clothes. They're worshiping him because he's God, and it's humbling when you go to Africa, man.
Yeah, wait a minute, you said it was called The Experience.
Yeah, it was an experience.
There
for
was
us,
an experience
for us. None of us sung a note, but it was something I'll never, ever, 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 ever forget.
See, that's sort of, I was at what church was I at? It was a church I was at, and the pastor ended up, the choir was so lit, mm-hmm. they were so on fire, mm-hmm. that he never preached a sermon. It literally transitioned from praise and worship, and the experience just continued for the next hour. Mm-hmm. And he talked and they sang, and it was just unbelievable.
And
the reason I want to ask that, because you led the choir Fountain of Praise in mm-hmm. Houston. And there are a lot of folk, there are a lot of preachers who are like, look, okay, enough, I got to do my thing.
Time, right.
But then there are others who understand you allow the Spirit to move, you allow God to move, and if it's flowing, it's flowing. And if the agenda gets changed, it gets changed. But that's when you're in tune with the room and the people in the room. Yeah.
Well, I got my start as when I was 20 years old. I was music director for James Cleveland. So a lot of people don't know that. But I learned about how to watch the mood in a room and to flow with the spirit. He was a very spontaneous man. Most of the hits that he made were things that just kind of happened.
Not planned, all organic.
Just like he would say, high blood, low blood, no blood at all. Like, he just had the quickest wit. And I learned a lot of that from him. And then before I came to Houston, I was music director at West Angeles Church in Los Angeles with Bishop Charles Blake. And that's where the black praise and worship movement started, at his church. And so I've learned to just kind of go with the flow.
Define that. What is the black praise and worship
movement? Before praise and worship started, we had what was called devotion, mm-hmm. where a deacon would get up, oh, I love the Lord, he heard my cry. Mm-hmm. Well, stuff like that. Or, have you tried Jesus? He's all right. Patrick Henderson, at the leading of Bishop Blake, Patrick Henderson was the minister of music at West Angeles. He and a lady named Judy McAllister came together and took songs that they got from Oral Roberts University, a more Caucasian experience, and they took those songs and blackified them. They put some Lowry salt on them, some onion powder.
They put some Tony Chachere's Creole seasoning on it.
Chachere, yeah, and Lowry salt. And the first time, I'll never forget, at West Angeles, which is a Church of God in Christ, Judy got up and said, as the deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth. The people was looking like throwing rotten egg, like the Apollo, literally. And we just kept doing it and kept doing it and kept doing it. And now it's like, you can't get away from praise and worship.
Well, the thing is, look, I was born and raised Catholic.
Okay.
And the decision to found the church was in my grandparents' living room. And the reality is, our culture is different. How we walk and how we talk and how we act. To your point, what we retained from mm-hmm. the motherland, the beat. The dancing, or as preacher would say, that itching foot of ours, and that to me is something that we should never apologize for. Mm-hmm. That is what makes us unique and distinct.
It is. You cannot have a worship experience in Africa without them dancing.
And not just dancing. It's flags.
The oldest mother.
It's whistles.
The oldest mother in the church will be dropping it like it's hot. Just like there's no insecurity about movement.
Uninhibited.
And no, right.
Ain't nobody sweat. Well, what so and so think? They like, look, I ain't here for you.
And the men out worship the women.
Oh yes.
It's almost shameful for a woman to out in Africa. For a woman to praise God as hard as a man, but here men have different, you know, refinement and everything with regard to worshiping God. But it all comes from the motherland.
It does. You mentioned Japan, and mm-hmm. it's amazing that a lot of blues artists and soul artists talk about again how black music, if you
they
will,
love it,
how it just. How other people receive it. What has been a particular place other than Japan that shocked you in your travels when you went, oh, y'all get down with our stuff like this?
Not really shocked me that they accept what we do, but a lot of certain countries in Europe, we do a lot of tours in Europe where they would know like the BBB song on a record. Not the A songs. They knew, you know, one time we did this fabulous opera house in Italy, and they held up this song. They had posters like, please sing. I was like, oh my God, we've never sung that song before after the record.
So here's like, oh, here's a standard playlist. We know what the hits are.
No, after I had a song.
They go deep.
My song, We Lift Our Hands in the Sanctuary, went platinum and made me from being a black artist to being a world artist.
Right.
And I started opening my thinking to like, you know, it's a whole big world. I toured after James Cleveland passed, I worked with Andre Crouch for like 2 years, which opened my thinking because he stayed in Europe. James Cleveland hated Europe. He liked collard greens and cornbread. Period. Andre Crouch wanted foie gras and, you know, pheasant in Europe and all that. And so going to that realm with Andre, I was like, whoa, it's a big world. And so after Sanctuary hit, I literally became a world artist. So I started experimenting with all different kinds of music and all different kinds of sound.
Why is it important for you, why is it important from your estimation that brands like McDonald's embrace this aspect of the black experience, gospel music, doing this tour, taking it across the country? Why is that important?
My last CD, and this is not a plug, but my last CD is called Bless Somebody Else. And I did a song with Yolanda and Mary Mary and Smokey and Fred Hammond and John Key and Kiki Wyatt and Faith Evans, like 16 artists came together to do this song about when I'm blessed, I have to bless somebody else. And I think McDonald's, they're putting their money where their mouth is. You know, not just saying that we embrace the community, but they're showing it. Gospel music, and in particular, is like a staple in the black experience. And it's a way to ensure that we can all come together, all kinds of people. I've done the tour several times, and it's amazing to see sometimes when we were in certain cities, people would come 2 hours early, standing outside waiting to get in. Some dressed to the nines, some dressed in sweats and stuff, but it's like, you know what, McDonald's is bringing the community together and letting them experience for free what some of them would never be able to afford to see all of us together at one time.
But also, because you have a lot of companies that, oh, hold up, you know, now you're talking about faith, you're talking about religion, and it's not like when black folk do gospel, we don't
hold back.
We don't remove the Jesus.
The
and
J
the God
word.
Right.
The J
right.
word. The capital J word. Yeah, and that's really, really commendable that they allow us to be who we are.
Speaking of who we are, is there? So I love asking this question because you never know what the response is. Is there something or someone that you would love to do something musically with? Does not have to be a gospel artist. Mm-hmm. That you just really like, man, I would love to do something with this person.
I really want to produce Donnie McClurkin next. And we always talk about it. I just feel like my songs have the kind of majesty that his voice carries. I've worked with a lot of people because of my involvement at West Angeles. So I've worked with a lot of celebrities, a lot of things that I'm on that you might not know about.
Such as?
Well, I've worked with Stevie and Gladys. And I actually have a publishing credit with Stevie Wonder, which is like nobody does. We did a song for Pinocchio, and he knew me from church. And he did. It was a big hit in Europe, but it never really hit here. And it was a song called Hold On To Your Dream. And I dared to say, I got an idea for the hook. And he was like, oh my God, I love it. So that was an honor. I would love,
It's gotta be somebody.
I'm trying to think.
Gotta be somebody with you.
Michael Jackson. Too late.
Well, yeah, too late.
Whitney Houston.
Too late.
Too late. I worked with Aretha, got to meet Queen. And know her toward the end of her life.
So Queen was amazing.
It was great, so. Yeah, with you.
Oh, I don't get paid to sing. I get paid to talk. I get paid to talk.
And you
see,
do
we had to mix in sort of that.
That's what I do. Stay in your lane.
That's my lane. My whole mama, my all her sisters, our whole family, we sang. We did the choir stuff, but no. That was
Celine Dion.
Ooh,
I want to write a song for her.
Yeah. Have you ever met her?
I've never met her, and I've seen her like 5 times. I think that she's probably the most perfect singer that's on earth today. Not soulful. I'm not comparing her to anybody else. But as far as the instrument is perfect, so she has a black background singer, right? So I was like, everybody black pretty much knows who I am, right? So I walked up and he said, hello, I am from France. So he didn't know me. So I've never met her yet.
All right, so we gotta figure out. So you never met her. You love to write a song for Celine Dion.
Write a song for her.
See, I gotta think who knows Celine Dion.
And Beyonce. I think Beyonce should do an inspirational song.
Okay.
And we used to be neighbors. She lived before the split up of Destiny's Child. They lived across the lake from me. So I would see her all the time. She's really, really, really a beautiful person.
So you need to run that by her?
I know.
Okay. So here's the deal. So Steve Payman is her COO of mm-hmm. the company.
Okay.
So I'm gonna hit Steve.
Cool.
Then I gotta figure out who knows Celine Dion. I don't know. Maybe Lionel Richie knows Celine Dion. I gotta figure that one out. Okay. So we'll see if we can make that arrangement.
There you go.
So we can make that arrangement. Last question for you. And that is.
And I'll buy you a African outfit.
Ain't no thing. Ain't no thing.
I'll fly to Africa and pick one out yourself.
That not a problem. That ain't a problem. I'm gonna figure out who knows Celine Dion. Yeah. I'm gonna figure out who knows Celine Dion. I'm trying to think who else. Who else would be in that space? Yeah. I think Lionel Richie probably, out of all people
probably
I know,
so.
Lionel probably knows Celine Dion. He probably knows Celine mm-hmm. Dion. What you think? Y'all think that? Hold on. Let me do this here. Let me see what time. I don't even go ahead and, you know, since you're just going to, you trying to challenge me, Kurt Carr. You trying to challenge me. So I don't know what. Let me go see if you know.
It was the Clark Sisters, but I just did them.
Clark Sisters.
Yeah, I have a new song with them that's about to come out.
I'm gonna see if Lionel pick up the phone. So if he don't pick up the phone, we're gonna shoot a video.
Okay.
We're gonna shoot a video, and that'll do it. Well, see, knowing him, he's somewhere.
Will he answer the phone? Say hello.
He's somewhere in you. He might be in the Middle East.
Is he gonna answer the phone? Say hello.
He might be.
Isn't me you're looking for?
He will answer. He will answer. What up, frat? Lionel Richie's an alpha.
Yes, I know.
All right, we're going to do this video right here.
Cool.
Okay, so Lionel, I'm interviewing Kurt Carr.
Hey, Mr. Richie.
So.
Jesus is love.
And Jesus is an alpha. He's a sinner. And so we're sitting here. He says he would absolutely, out of all the artists, he would love to write a song for Celine Dion. I figure out of all the people I know, you probably know Celine Dion. But if you do know Celine Dion, we need to hook that up. But you probably need to also do something with Lionel.
Hey, but Jesus is love too.
There you go. So let me know. Hit me back, frat. And yes, you know, let's hook a Sigma up. Let's show.
I was actually listening to the song recently. That track is great. The way it builds, it's perfect. It's a great song, timeless.
Well, you let us know. You hit me back. And then we'll see if we can hook that up.
I think I'm gonna bring that song back. I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna do it in church.
Okay.
I'm gonna bring it back.
All right. Holla.
Peace.
All right. We'll send it to him right now.
Okay.
Right. We'll see if we can do that. Man, yeah, always good to see you.
Man, it's a pleasure.
Indeed. Keep doing
Thank
your
you
thing.
Thank you so much.
Keep hanging. And then if you ever go to Japan and go back to Japan and lose your luggage, you know who you can call.
Little Kirk.
Yeah, Little Kirk Carr. Appreciate it.
Thank you, man.